والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين. أما بعد فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. يا أيها الإنسان إنك كادح إلى ربك كدحا فملاقيه. فأما من أوتي كتابه بيمينه فسوف يحاسب حسابا يسيرا وينقلب إلى أهله مسرورا وأما من أوتي كتابه وراء ظهره فسوف يدعو ثبورا ويصلى سعيرا إنه كان في أهله مسرورا إنه ظن أن لن يحور بلى إن ربه كان به بصيرا آمنت بالله صدق الله العظيم اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه السلام علينا وعلى عباد الله الصالحين أما بعد As most of you will be aware that we are in the last days of Dhul Hijjah has just about come to an end and beginning of the first Islamic month Muharram. They are both very important months in the sense that one is ending and the other is beginning. And in this month, many lessons which you have learned or you should have learned, because all over the world, even kuffar, even non-Muslims, they came to know that Muslims perform something called Hajj, the pilgrimage in Makkatul Mukarrama. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in the Quran about his house, Hudallil Alameen. إِنَّ أَوَّلَ بَيْتٍ وُضِعَ لِلنَّاسِ لَلَّذِي بِبَكَّةٍ مُبَارَكًا وَهُدًى لِلْعَالَمِينَ Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned, verily, surely, the first house which has been built and made for people to worship in the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is in Makkah. And it is a blessed place, وَهُدًى لِلْعَالَمِينَ and guidance for all the world, all the mankind, there's guidance. It was built by Sayyidina Adam Alayhi Islam and then the second major built of it, we know from Sayyidina Ibrahim. And Sayyidina Ibrahim, as you know, is considered in high esteem chief children of Israel, and Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam came from his descendants. And the guidance at one time through Moses, peace be upon him, or at one time through Jesus, was still they were following the millate Ibrahim, and we also, the Muslims, as we read the Durood Sharif in Salah, Allahumma salli ala Muhammadin wa ala Ali Muhammadin kama sallaita ala Ibrahim wa ala Ali Ibrahim innaka hamidun majid. So a person, as the month is ending, we should all take some lessons from it. And I mentioned previously as well, there are major five lessons which you can take from this month, which is related to the Kaaba, related to the Hajj, which will benefit you throughout the year. The first lesson which one can take, and especially this majlis, is of the Brother Naveed's grandparents for Islae Sawab, for benefiting, because Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, when the son or a child of Adam dies, his book of deeds is closed. He cannot do any more good deeds to his credit. But he, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, said, except actually three amals, they still benefit him. One is that his children who do dua for him, who perform hajj on his behalf, or who give sadaqah or do any good deed and gift the reward of to their parents or grandparents. And secondly, if that person himself has done such a kind of virtue that the benefit of it is still ongoing, like for example, they helped someone, they built a bridge, they built a well, they built something which is beneficial for people, and the creation is still benefiting after his death, the reward is transferred to that person, which is known as sadaqah jariyah. And the third is that if they have passed on any good word to the others, they have passed on any message, good message of Islam, of good character, of deen, a hadith, a verse of Quran, or taught anyone to read Quran, or have invited anyone towards good path, towards prayers, towards righteous thing, then as though, or although the person have died, until that amal or that person will be doing that good deed, in the book of deeds of this person still, it will be written. And this is all to do with, obviously you can only understand when you understand the spiritual, the journey of the spirit, the journey of the spirit. When you understand the journey of spirit, only then the deen and also this dunya makes sense to you. Otherwise, it is chaos in this world. There's no justice to be seen. Who is going to give justice to those babies which, since Adam al-Islam, which have been killed innocently, wrongly? Those women who, even we do not know, they've been killed, dishonored and raped, and there's no case in any court of the world for them. All those people who have wronged others, defrauded others, and people have suffered heart attacks due to fraud and other things, but who is going to compensate them? So this, any thinking person would say and would think that yes, justice should be done. Justice should be done. If anyone is sacrificing, is selflessly doing something good, They have a good character. They are sacrificing their own needs and time and effort and energy for the welfare of people, for the goodness of people. The mind, the intellect says they should be rewarded. But who is going to reward them? Sometimes they are not even appreciated. And if they are wronged, if some people are wronged, like in the world, sometimes brother goes against another brother, wife turns against the husband, husband turns against the wife, sometimes country against another country, a nation against another nation, a business partner against another business partner. But in many times, justice is not done. Someone actually violates the rights and the other is just left helplessly crying. So any logical thinking person at least thinks that yes, justice should be done. That person should have justice who's been wronged, and that person who's done good and sacrifice, he should be rewarded. But the next question is, who is going to reward them? Who is going to give them justice? Who is going to give justice that innocent infant who's been killed? Me and you, we can't bring them back to life. We can't give another life to that child, no matter what we do. Even if the other person is killed in the punishment, still actually, what is the justice? What benefit does it do to that child? If a rapist is punished for 30 years, what benefit does go to the person whose life they've ruined, that's ruined? All this demands that there should be ultimate justice. And the name of that ultimate justice is the Day of Judgment, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَمَنْ يَعْمَلْ مِثْقَالَ زَرَّةٍ خَيْرًا يَرَى. Let aside killing someone, let aside defrauding, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, a speck, a small speck of dust, a particle, a small particle of dust. If anyone has done any good, yarahu, they will see it and they will actually benefit from it and they will be rewarded. If no one rewards them, if no one appreciates them, community is not appreciating, countries are not appreciating, their friends are not appreciating, Allah subhanahu, I will appreciate. Yarahu, and he will see it. That is why we are asked to do any good deeds for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for the sake of the divine, not for any other. وَمَنْ يَعْمَلْ مِثْقَالَ زَرَّةٍ شَرًّا يَرَى. Let aside doing big wrongs, committing crime, killing innocent people, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, even you have done wrong to an animal, even a small, an atom's weight wrong you've done, yarahu, you will see it there as well. And you have to pay for it. And the other will get justice as well. As Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, that the animals, they are not responsible for good and bad because they don't have that kind of intellect, nor they are charged. But he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that they will be resurrected, they will be brought to life, every ant, every mosquito, every mouse, every dog, every cat, they will be brought back to life so that justice can be given to them as well, if a person have wrong. So this is the scenario of the, you may say, the Day of Judgment. Actually, so people, they feel a sense of responsibility that everyone is answerable to the ultimate King of Kings, the Judge of Judges, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Ahkamul Hakimin. It's mentioned, just to make us understand, one example was given. Once a king called his ministers, his three ministers, and he gave them three bags, three big sacks. He called them and gave them three big sacks which could be filled with anything. He said, go to the garden of fruits and whatever you see in my garden, royal garden, and fill them with fruits. Fill them with fruits and vegetables and whatever you know. Now to do this was an extra burden upon these ministers. They were used to luxurious life and go into the heat, out in the heat, in the gardens, and to do this hard work was a big work. So first of them was sincere to the king. He loved the king. And he said, king is going to see this. So he went around the garden and chose the best of fruits. Best of fruits, vegetables, whatever drink he could. And he filled big sack of it, actually, so that it is the best quality of the food in there. The second one thought that king is not going to see, he's not going to be bothered what's inside the sack. So he, whatever fruit he found, he didn't check good quality, bad quality fruit, rotten fruit, or not, it's not ripe, or whatever. He just filled it, and the king just wanted to see it. The other one, the third one, thought that the king is not going to be interested in fruits and vegetables. He has plenty, so he was lazy. He filled it with grass and other things which were just lying down on the garden. He wasn't bothered to go around the garden and do this hard work. So they all filled it. They brought to the king, and all sacks were full. The king said to them, he commanded them that send three of them into a remote prison and don't give them anything to eat except what they have with them. So they were all put in a prison with their own sacks, what they have brought. And this is for 1 month, don't give them anything at all. Finish. They have enough food. The first one of them felt very good in the sense that he thought that he has the, instead of king eating it, I will eat the fresh fruits and vegetables. He had enough supplies for 1 month, so he was very healthy, happily living. Everything else was there. Only food was not there. Bedding, other things, there was no other discomfort. And so he was very healthy. The second one, who mixed different rotten and good fruit, I think, he also survived, but he became ill, and he was actually because of disease and the wear and food finished as well, and the half of it was not good anyway. So he had fallen ill, but he survived. He was very weak at the end, but he survived. The third one, who had filled it with grass and other things, has really nothing to eat. He only survived 5-6 days, whatever. He ate some petals and some leaves and things, but how long he could survive on them. So he actually died a very painful death. Giving this example, the awliya Allah, the mashayikh, the sages of the ummah, the luminaries, the people, the wise people say that you are also in a garden. This dunya is that garden. And the king is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And you are the like main creation, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given honor to the Bani Adam. All other creation have not got so much honor as actually the human being has. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, وَلَقَدْ كَرَّمْنَا بَنِي Adam. That Allah has honored the Bani Adam. So Allah has sent you in this garden of dunya to fill your sacks, meaning your life, and using your time and your life with actually good deeds. The good fruits are the good deeds. So those people who are filling their sack with good, the others are some bad thing, some good thing, good deeds, bad deeds, etc. And the other, third one, completely wasted, all, nothing, useless. When all of us, we are going to go towards Akhirah, towards the grave, towards the Barzakh, the world to come there, and on the Day of Judgment in Akhirah, we will have to survive on what we have collected from this garden of dunya. We have to survive on whatever we have collected. No, nothing will be added there or taken away. That day, if you have collected the good one, good fruits, meaning good deeds, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, لَا خَوْفٌ عَلَيْهِمْ وَلَا هُمْ يَحْزَنُونَ. No fear, nor they will have any fear, nor any worry. Is what to come, or there will be any other worry for them, that they will be eating, they will be enjoying for whatever they have been doing. And the other one who's mixed things, this is like the example of sinful people who's not been forgiven, and they've mixed bad deeds with good deeds. They will fall sick, meaning they will have to go through some punishment in grave or in Akhirah, in the hell, but finally end up, actually, at least they will survive to the paradise. And the third one have nothing. Their iman has died. Their good deeds actually are not there at all. Their iman is even not actually present. They have not bothered. They are just, they got distracted by the beauty of the garden, which they were sent to actually pick up fruits and save them. They just became interested in sightseeing in the garden. Oh, what a beautiful garden. What's there? What's there? So example of those is us in dunya, who's been distracted by cars, by luxuries, and by money. But all these things, if they were to stay forever, the good and well. But unfortunately, there is a time. There is a time, set time, which you have to go. Even no matter, let aside you are in the business, let aside you are sitting in the home. What to say? Have you not seen that those people who were in prayers in Kaaba and in Tawaf, when death came, it didn't spare them. Angel of death didn't say, oh, they are doing Tawaf, they are doing Salah, they are in the house of Kaaba, Allah's house. I should, you know, let them a little bit of respite or a little bit of flexibility. No. Exactly. If someone was in prayer, is taken from there. Someone in Safa doing the Sa'i is taken there. Someone is in Tawaf, he's been taken there. Someone is child, he's been taken. Someone is woman, he's been taken. That is the how the strict this actually timing is. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, لَا يَسْتَخِرُونَ سَعَةٌ وَلَا يَسْتَخْدِمُونَ. Not even for 1 second, 1 split second, it is going to prolong or it will shorten. So this is the real essence that what we are facing, all this situation. No one, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, even to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "O ma ja'alna, we've not, O our beloved, O Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, before you, until you have come and before you, we've not sent anyone to live forever on this face of the earth." No, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he also departed from this world. Although there is life after death, that's what we are discussing, that's what the majlis is about. If Brother Naveed believes his grandparents have, now they're extinct, they don't exist, there is no need for majlis, there's no need for sending reward, there's no need for prayers. He or others, Muslims, they believe that death is not the name of extinction. Death is name of just transfer. You have come from your home. You are sitting in the mosque. Have you died? Are you finished? Yes, from the house, from the family, it's as though you're not present there. That's right. But have you finished? But no, there is new life here. You are sitting in the mosque. Similarly, a person who dies, only his place changes, the spirit passes. I will just show you a snapshot of the picture of the the world of the spirits. Here, you know, with me, if I can show you. Yes, you can just look at the screen for 5-10 minutes very quickly to go through the journey of the spirit, which we discussed. So look, here is different faces of your life, not anyone else's, but your life. Firstly, there was nothing in existence. You and me, no, we were not existent. Everyone has a date of birth and also a date of death. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created firstly us in here. It's mentioned in the Quran, and this is also lesson of Arafah, where people gather for Hajj. That was the place where this world of spirits, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brought all the spirits. When He created them, there was a time when there was no light, there was no spirit. As He said, let there be light, and there was light. And Allah Azza wa Jalla created the spirits. The spirits were like babies. They didn't know anything. Where was it? Where the Hajj is performed. The Medan or Arafah. That's why I'm saying this is also a lesson. All of the worships of Islam are connected to each other. Connected to the real purpose. Even Salah, Zakah, Hajj, whatever. Especially the Arafah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gathered the spirits there. He created them first. They didn't know, they were like babies. Firstly, it was said to them that, oh, arwah of, oh, the spirits, they heard the voice representing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I am offering you a trust and amana, a freedom of will. What is that amana? Freedom of will, by which you do good, bad, you deny Allah, you accept Allah, you do whatever you want regarding good and bad deeds. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned to the spirits that I'm going to give you a gift of freedom. If you use it well, you will enjoy my company, my vision, my beauty, you will enjoy in Jannah. But if you use it badly or abuse it, then you'll be punished. The spirits were very happy to be with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They loved to hear it from Allah. They loved to see. They said, yes, Ya Allah, we took that covenant. We took that gift. That's what the tick means. Other creation, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, like the sun, the moon, stars, animals, birds, etc. They didn't. They are not given this freedom, which we have. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, good and well, you have accepted. Now, alastu bi rabbikum. What do you think? Am I not your Lord? You are my servants? Yes, Ya Rabbal Alameen. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, okay. Now you will be sent to a place called earth to be tested. Your free will be tested. That how you utilize it. So now, finally, let's say here, we are here on the face of the earth here. Here you are, and here am I, and you are also here at the moment, in the middle. In the very critical point you are. Here you are being tested in this very brief life. It is 60, 70, 80 years, but even if you analyze them, 13 years are gone in childhood, 15 years in work and education, cleaning, bathroom, toilet, sleeping. All, if you add, only 6 years remain from 60 years. All other 54 years are spent in these activities. So 6 years you are being tested, tried and tested here of that freedom of will. And then, now all our parents or grandparents who passed away, they have gone to the grave and then to the barzakh, the intermediate world. And Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, either the grave is garden of Jannah or a pit of hell. So for the good person, this is the place. They will be enjoying, there are rivers, there are the company of Salihin and Malaika and good environment. If not, this is the journey. Who will save us from there? How we'll tolerate, it doesn't matter we tolerate or not. That is the point there. And then on the day of judgment, as I was saying, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will bring and everyone will be brought to justice. As the Quran mentioned, وَإِذَا الْمَوْءُودَةُ سُئِلَتْ, when the innocent female girl who the Arab used to kill, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, وَإِذَا الْمَوْءُودَةُ سُئِلَتْ, when the innocent female will be asked, بِأَيِّ زَمْبٍ قُتِلَتْ, for which sin you were killed. And this day, 50,000 years long, and that it is for judgment, and only there will be people who will be under the shade of the Arsh of Allah. There will be people who will be enjoying. It will be like sightseeing scene for them. And for others, they have not seen any more horror scene and environment from there. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, a person will not be able to move unless he answers five questions on the day of judgment. Number one, it will be said to you, servant, what was your purpose and mission of life? What did you do with that life? What was the thing which made you wake in the morning? What made you move? What was the center of your life? Was it dunya? Was it Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Was it akhirah? Was it money? Was it women? Was it just desires and ego? And this? What was the center of your life? Was it politics? Was it business? Obviously, everyone has a central point around which your life revolves. It's like the earth, the star, the planets have the sun in the middle and nirvana. Similarly, you also have, that will be the first question. What was your mission, gentlemen? What was your mission? What was your purpose of love? Central point. Person have to answer in detail. Secondly, it will be said that there was a time in your life when everything, every organ, every capability, every ability was at its peak, which is the youth age. Your mind was working very well, your body was working very well, you were healthy, your teeth were healthy, your liver was healthy, when you could do anything. How did you spend? When you were in the youthful age, what was your center? You said, okay, I am young, I want to build up this career. It is about career. One is career for 15, 20 years. One is career, long-term career in grave and in Jannah. So what was your center in youthful age? No, I want to build my family. Family can break down in 1 minute. Few seconds, it can be. Businesses go bust. Others, life actually turns away from you. But what was your, what was the youthful age? This was the second. I can do whatever you like, whatever I like, whatever you like. That's what people, you can't do whatever you like. Yes, you can choose between good and bad. Can you stop aging? You say, I am very young, oh, don't bother, don't tell me about religion, I'll spend my life however I like. Okay, stop aging then. Stop becoming ill. Never become upset. Always stay young. Do whatever you like. When you cannot do, never die, don't die. When you don't have this ability, then don't pay this lip service, oh, it's my life, I'll do whatever I like. How can you do whatever you like? How can you do whatever you like? Even if you want, you can't do. You cannot stop time, you cannot stop aging, you cannot stop people upsetting you, you cannot stop suffering loss, going through illness, or living forever, being young forever, having all the ability, always be in good mood. You can't. No one can. Yes, there is a place which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put and made this for this reason, that is called Jannah, not in this world. So here, all you have choices. You are 5 foot, 6 foot, can you be 8 foot tall? You have color, brown, green, whatever. You can, how much you can change your color? Those people who had plastic surgery, they look much more worse than before, than their natural look. Meaning you cannot, you have the desire to look how you want and think. That is good. You have the desire to live forever and stay young forever, but the place to do that is Jannah, not this earthly life. The third thing which a person will be asked, what was your means of income? What was your means of income? Through which means your income came? What was the source of your income? Halal, haram, these things, this is accounts. We have a charity, brothers run the Baal Trust. Recently, one of the body like charity commission, they said, we just want to check your account, how you are running. And the brothers are getting together, that's for how we are going to present accounts, this is what they will ask, etc., etc., etc. Or you have a business, you present account to the tax man, you have to prepare, and you get worried, what about on the day of judgment? When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to judge your accounts of your life, of your every day, every night. As this someone said, when you people don't sin normally when they are in people, they think, oh, they are a little bit shy. But when they are alone sometimes, oh, no, my wife's not looking, my husband's not looking, my friends are not there. Now I can be the little devil which I want. No one is looking. So one of the mashayikh said, when you are alone and you don't have any witnesses to witness you, know that the judge is a witness himself of your sin now, which is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Other witnesses are small thing. But when the judge who is going to decide, he is witness himself now when you are alone. There is no other witness, except malaika or anything. But when the judge is witness, he's looking, then who are you hiding? What are you doing? So what were your sources of income? Because the source of income comes, they are going to affect your spirituality, your children. Fourth question on the day of judgment will be, what was your expenditure on? Which thing you said is my money, I can spend? No, it's not your money. Who said it's your money? You are a trustee. If a mosque, if any organization give you some money to spend on your fuel or on your food, etc., only, or you can spend on this, you are a trustee of that money. You can't actually use whatever way you want. In Islam, Maliki Yawm, everyone, everything is owned by Allah, and whatever you have, only you are trustee for it. You are a trustee, it's not your money. So I can't even waste water. Even though I'm in the river bank, I'm in the sea, I can't waste water. I will be sinful. I can't waste my money, no matter I have earned. But I can't waste, because it's not owned by me. And originally, it's the owned by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And I'm a trustee, I can only utilize it in the lawful way. And the fifth question will be, how much knowledge you put into practice. Now this is, everyone knows little. They know the major wrongs, the major rights, the major sins, the major good deeds. Every human being almost have some sense of it. Muslims, they know. So a person will. So this is the on the day of judgment, these things. After that, people will not see any escape. The bad one, the evil one. Only there will be one escape, that will be the bridge of Sirat. They will run towards it. But the bridge of Sirat will also become a source of punishment. The bridge itself is a living being. It will punish them and it will throw them into the fire of hell itself. And when the good person, when the righteous spirits and their people come, the bridge will welcome them. It will widen up. It will help them. They will be like teleported in split second to the other side, which is hundreds of years of distance, but to the paradise. So this is very briefly the journey of the spirit. And all our grandparents, great-grandparents, they're all in Barzakh now, somewhere. And we all will be gathered here. And we are here for temporal nature. There have been millions of people living, millions have passed away. We are going to pass away as well. And that is what we teach here in the center, the methodology, the prophetic methodology, as how you can live a life according to the prophetic principles, according to the best moral level, character. Character is not what you think and what me think, what I think. For example, some people are born with some characteristics. As a gift, Rasulullah said, some people as a gift has generous. They are shy. They have, for example, tolerance, that is. But others you have to build. Don't have your own ideology of character. Many philosophers in the past, actually, Avicenna and others, and Plato and others, they had their own idea, of own philosophy of moral. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not accept those philosophy. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala himself has given guidance to 124,000 lesser more prophets that what is a moral character. And especially this majlis, as I said, it is for parents, but I will just read at the end few ahadith which actually outlines the main picture of Islam, of a believer, what parents are. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, it is said, qala Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam fi hajjatil wada, that in the last hajj, like we have done our hajj, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam did hajj, and he gave a khutbah last, and in that khutbah he said, ala ukhbirukum bil mu'min, shall I not tell you who is a believer? Who is a believer? If I ask you, you ask me, well, the believer is the one who says this, this. But Rasulullah said something different. He said, ala ukhbirukum bil mu'min, shall I not tell you who is a believer? Then he himself said, man aminahu nasu ala amwalihim wa anfusihim. A believer is the one who people trust about their wealth, their property, and their lives, and meaning their honors. If anyone trusts, if you are such a person, that a person, neighbor, without thinking, will put £50,000 with you, actually, and he doesn't need to worry about where his pounds will be lost, then it is a sign of a believer. If he trusts you with your life, that is a belief. If he trusts with your honor, he can leave his wife, his daughter, actually, or anywhere, or he can trust you. If you have that kind of trust, you have that kind of character, Rasulullah said, this is a believer from whom others' properties, wealth, and honors are safe, they are the believer. And he said, who is a Muslim? Prophet said, al Muslimu man salim al nasu min lisanihi wa yadi. A Muslim is the one from whom all other people, from his tongue and from his hands, his authority, are safe. That is about Islam and mu'min, Rasulullah ﷺ said. And about parents, Prophet ﷺ said, one person said, أَقْبَلَ رَجُلٌ إِلَىٰ نَبِي صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ. One person came to Rasulullah. He said, "Ubayyuka ala al-hijra wal-jihad ibtaghi al-ajra min Allah." That I have promised and I have given you bay'ah upon that I will migrate and I will do jihad under your instruction. Prophet said, "Qala fahal min walidayka ahadun hayy?" Yes, you are migrating with me. You are going on jihad, but your parents are alive or they have all finished, so then you can go. But are your anyone alive? Anyone looking after them? He said, yes, bal kilahuma hai, both of them are alive. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, fatabtaghil ajra min Allah. He said, you really want ajr from Allah? That's why you want to go on jihad? That's why you want to do hijrah with me? You want pleasure of Allah? You want Allah to be happy with you? He said, naam, yes. قَالَ فَرْجِعْ إِلَىٰ وَالِدَيْكَ فَأَحْسِنْ صُحْبَتَهُمَا. Then go back to your parents and be good with them and serve them. You will get the pleasure of Allah. In another hadith, Rasulullah ﷺ said, one person came, أَسْتَشِيرُهُ فِي الْجِهَادِ. One Sahabi, Anjahima, he himself said, I went to the Prophet ﷺ and he said, I said, shall I go in jihad? You give me permission. فَقَالَ النَّبِيُّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ سَلَّمْ أَلَكَ وَالِدًا. Have you got any parents alive? قُلْتُ نَعَمْ. قَالَ إِلْزَمْهُمَا فَإِنَّ الْجَنَّةَ تَحْتَ أَرْجُلِهِمَا. He said, then be close to them and serve them. فَإِنَّ الْجَنَّةَ تَحْتَ أَرْجُلِهِمَا. Jannah, paradise, you're going jihad to go into paradise. Jannah, that paradise under the feet of your both parents. So here we learn from that sometimes people, because of less knowledge, they've not, they say Jannah is under the feet of the mother. That's right, but here Rasulullah is saying also under the feet of the father. He's mentioning both up here actually. It's not a one-sided story. Another Sahabi radiallahu ta'ala anhu says that he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, qala qala Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, like you are living old people here, he said, naumuka ala sarir barran bi walidayk tudhikhuma wa yudhikanika afdalu min jihadika bi sayfi fi sabilillah. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, before going to your bed, you should be in state that you make your parents happy and talk to them, serve them, massage them. It's to such extent that they become, they smile. He said, this is better than actually fighting in the way of Allah in jihad with the sword just before you go to sleep. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentioned. Another hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, "Inna min qala Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, inna min akbaril kabair an yal'ana ar-rajulu walidayh." He said, "Akbarul kabair, they are kabira sins, they are major sins." But he said, "The father of the major sins, the biggest of the biggest, the major of the major." So they are big sins, small sins, major sins. And he said, Akbarul Kabair, then even bigger than the bigger ones. The most bigger sin is a person use abusive language towards his parents. Abusive language, even actually abusive language. Qila ya Rasulullah, it was said to Prophet, ya Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, wa kayfa yal'anu. How can a person use abusive language towards his parents? Imagine, even people were living in that society where mushriks were, where kuffar were, where Muslims were, in time of Rasulullah, in Makkah and Medina, even they were disbelievers, but they could not think, how can a person use bad language towards parents? They could not even think, even kuffar couldn't think that. Because of the question. Prophet Sallallahu said, قَالَ يَسَبُّ الرَّجُلُ أَبَرْ رَجُلُ فَيَسُبُّ أَبَاهُ وَيَسُبُّ أُمَّهُ فَيَسُبَّ أُمَّهُ. He said, when you use abusive language towards another father, someone else's father and someone else's mother, they will use abusive language towards your father. And that's what I mean, that if when you, that don't use abusive or sarcastic or anyway negative actually language towards other parents, then as though you are using abusive language towards your own parents, actually. So this even the Prophet is awesome. In another hadith, Ata Rajulan, one person came, Ya Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Mata akunu muhsina. When will I become a good person? How will I know I am the best? I am the good person. I am a good Muslim. I am a good human being. When I pray a lot, when I do dhikr, when I go on jihad, he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, قَالَ إِذَا قَالَ جِيرَانُكَ أَنْتَ مُحْسِنْ فَأَنْتَ مُحْسِنْ. When your neighbor says you are a good man, you are a good woman, you are a good person, you are good. وَإِذَا قَالُوا إِنَّكَ مُسِيءٌ فَأَنْتَ. When your neighbor says that you are not a good person, you are not a good neighbor, you are not a good human being, then you are evil. It doesn't matter what you think about yourself. Everyone likes to think good of themselves. Koi bhi ye nahi kehta ki main bura hoon. Lekin Hazur Allah Islam peymana bata diya ki padosiyon se poochho. Independently ask them, what did really they think about you? And he, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, said in another hadith, last one I'll recite and finish here, anna Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam qal, inna min ahabbakum ilayya wa aqrabakum minni majlisan yawm al-qiyama ahasinukum akhlaqa. He said that the most dearest among you to me, he, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, said the most one, the one which I love most of from you, who is he? He said, the most beloved to me, which I love, who are closer to my heart, and on the day of judgment, they will be the most closest to me sitting, are those who have the best conduct with the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Who are best in dealing with the creation, with the people, with animals, with other thing. So Islam summarizes in two things. Having the most beautiful and good relationship with the divine, with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and having the most beautiful conduct with the creation of Allah. That's if you can do, alhamdulillah, you are Muslim, you are mu'min, as Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam saying. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala enable me firstly and yourself to act upon these teachings and to prepare for the final day, which is coming, and we might see each other on that day as well, and we shouldn't see each other hopefully with regret that we didn't follow, but rather actually with happiness, so that we did take heed to the advice and we are successful. Jazakumullah khairan jazaa. Subhanakallahumma bihamdika nashhadu an la ilaha illa ant nastaghfiruka wa natubu ilayk.
Assalamu alaikum, my dear brothers. As you've heard, the nasiya and the journey that you've heard, the journey of your spirit, and this was just the first part. That is the second part to it. Due to time constraint, Hazrat Sahab has not had time to go through the second half. But the first one is just to show you the reality and what is the answer now. What is your next step? How can one person then save themselves from the humiliation on the Day of Judgment? How can one person look forward to the Day of Judgment, to meeting Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? How a person can inwardly and outwardly resemble the Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? They do a course, a plan, a method. They've worked out how a person slowly, day by day, can bring themselves closer to the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. How a person can free themselves from the shackles of the shaitan. There is a system, there is a way. If any brother is interested, inshallah, if you see me later on after the majlis, after the zikr majlis, I will sit with you for 10-15 minutes and show you the plan, the course, this course of self-purification, how it works. It's suited to every individual tailor-made, that anybody, no matter what the circumstances are, it is good and can be suited to them. So please approach me and I will sit with you for 10-15 minutes and show you this course of self-purification. And they ask nothing other than you having the will want to change, and they will teach you for free. So alhamdulillah, anyone who's interested, please approach me after the majlis. The other thing I'd like to mention is there's some international jamaats going. There is, alhamdulillah, a blessed opportunity to participate in a spiritual dawah camp. This is planned for a long weekend retreat from the 22nd of October to Monday the 26th of October. So that'll be 4 days, for 4 days. And it will be in Denmark, in Copenhagen. So if ever anybody wants to go to that spiritual retreat, please give your name to Brother Javed. If I can ask Brother Javed if he's here to stand up so brothers know who you are. Brother Javed is at the back there. And if you need any further details, alhamdulillah, just approach him. Also, there is a spiritual retreat tour going to Fez in Morocco the first and second week of November for 5 to 7 days. brothers and sisters, both is open to, should give their names as soon as possible, or at the latest in 3 days, to Brother Saheed, if they want further details or want to show interest. So please approach me if you want to know who Brother Saheed is, and then I will give you their number or details as well, so you can get further information. And if you can go, you should go to these. It's very beneficial. I've been to them myself, and traveling and get away from the rat race, go in a good... amongst good company in a pure place as well. Alhamdulillah, you'll benefit. There is also another trip coming. Tariqah Muhammadiyah will be going to the USA. So there is an opportunity to partake in that for about 10 days from in the last half of November. So if there's any brother who wants to go participate in that as well, Alhamdulillah, give your names for that international trip as well. But if you can't go for work or financial problems or time, then there is local dawahs as well, camps going as well. And any moment, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not deny anyone of the circumstances. You don't get any more reward because you've traveled to the other side of the world. The work of deen needs to be done here. You'll get rewarded by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So there is local camps as well. That's happening locally, so participate in them as well. And if you want further details about when these are taking place as well, see Brother Javed as well. And finally, then I'll finish, it's back to basics. Islam for, you know, for the new or reverted Muslims, and for those want to learn the basics of Islam, there is regular Sunday classes at this Medina Masjid here every Sunday, where for those brothers, specifically for back to basics, but everybody is welcome. Any of the reverts, anyone who wants to know the basics of Islam, or anyone just wants to come. And, you know, the classes held in a very friendly atmosphere, relaxed atmosphere, so you can relax and chill and then, you know, talk to each other, a very friendly atmosphere. So please come along for that as well. And if you know of any people who could do and benefit from coming on the Sunday classes, please invite them or encourage them or tell them about these Sundays back to basic classes as well for that. Thank you very much indeed. Jazakallah khair. Inshallah, now we'll be doing the zikr majlis. First of all, the brothers can stand up and let some blood run down to your legs and everything. If you're doing it, then you can still. And then when you sit down, sit in the tashahhud position, which is the position that is most beloved to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Please sit yourselves down. And then as you get tired, you can change your positions. The most important thing, please sit yourselves down. Jazakallah. The most important thing is, please, brothers, in future, if you're going to cause disturbance, I won't let you stand up. This is only to read the thing, not for you to chit-chat. It's against the adabs of the majlis. Please control yourselves. The three keys, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is with me, watching me and hearing me. Beseech Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Imagine the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala above the gathering. And imagine the nur from that descending onto the teacher and onto yourselves, eradicating the darkness that we've accumulated during the week. Jazakallah khair. Thank you.
So inshallah, we are going to recite few verses of Quran and names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala glorifying, so that we may send the reward of this as well to our deceased and whoever we will pray for, and it's for our own benefit. During the dhikr or remembrance, think that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is with us, watching us, hearing us. Try to be in the spiritual presence. Inshallah. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما. مولاي صل وسلم دائما أبدا. مولاي صل وسلم دائما أبدا. مولاي صل وسلم دائما أبدا على حبيبك خير الخلق كلهم. على حبيبك خير الخلق كلهم. مولاي صل وسلم دائما أبدا على حبيبك خير الخلق كلهم. محمد سيد الكونين والثقلين والفريقين من عرب ومن عجم. محمد سيد الكونين والثقلين والفريقين من عرب ومن عجم. مولاي صل وسلم دائما أبدا على حبيبك خير الخلق كن. فاعلم أنه لا إله إلا الله محمد رسول الله. لا إله إلا الله. لا
Allah.
Ya Allah, Ya Allah, Ya Allah. La ilaha illallah, La ilaha illallah, La ilaha illallah, La Muhammadur Rasulullah, Muhammadur Rasulullah, Muhammadur Rasulullah, La ilaha illallah, La ilaha illallah, La ilaha illallah, La ilaha illallah, 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 ya Allah, ya Allah, ya
Allah
لا إله إلا الله محمد رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم والله الذي الله الذي لا إله إلا هو والله الذي لا إله إلا هو عالم الغيب والشهادة عالم الغيب والشهادة عالم الغيب والشهادة عالم الغيب هو الرحمن الرحيم هو الرحمن الرحيم هو الرحمن الرحيم هو الرحمن والله الذي لا إله إلا هو والله الذي لا إله إلا هو والله الذي لا إله إلا الملك القدوس السلام الملك القدوس السلام الملك القدوس السلام الملك القدوس السلام المؤمن المهيمن العزيز المؤمن المهيمن العزيز المؤمن المهيمن العزيز الجبار المتكبر الجبار المتكبر الجبار الملك القدوس السلام المؤمن المهيمن العزيز الجبار المتكبر الملك القدوس السلام المؤمن المهيمن العزيز الجبار سبحان الله 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 عما يشركون سبحان الله عما Ya Hayyu Ya Qayyum La ilaha illa ant Ya Hayyu Ya Qayyum La ilaha illa ant Ya Hayyu Ya Qayyum La ilaha illa ant Subhanaka inni kuntu minal zalimin Subhanaka inni kuntu minal zalimin La ilaha illa ant Subhanaka inni kuntu minal zalimin La ilaha illa ant Subhanaka inni kuntu minal zalimin Ya Hayyu Ya Qayyum La ilaha illa anta Subhanaka inni kuntu minal أستغفر الله الذي لا إله إلا هو الحي القيوم وأتوب إليه أستغفر الله الذي لا إله إلا هو الحي القيوم وأتوب إليه أستغفر الله الذي لا إله إلا هو الحي القيوم وأتوب إليه اللهم صل على سيدنا ومولانا وعلى آله وأصحابه وسلم اللهم صل على سيدنا ومولانا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه وسلم اللهم صل على سيدنا ومولانا محمد وعلى الحمد لله رب العالمين سبحان ربي العلي على الوهاب اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى اله وصحبه اجمعين اللهم ربنا تقبل منا انك انت السميع العليم وتب علينا انك انت التواب الرحيم يا حي يا قيوم برحمتك نستغيث اصلح لنا شاننا كله ولا تكلنا الى انفسنا طرفه عين واغفر لنا وارحمنا ولوالدينا ولاقربائنا ولجميع المؤمنين والمؤمنات والمسلمين والمسلمات الاحياء منهم والاموات من الجنه والناس يا خير الغافرين يا ارحم الراحمين O Lord of the world, O sustainer of the universe and all the creation, have mercy upon us, accept our all good deeds, small, large, whatever we have done in our entire lives, Ya Rahman Rahimin, by your grace and mercy. Forgive our wrongdoings and forgive and overlook our shortcomings in your worship and serving you, Ya Rabbal Alameen. Ya Rahman Rahimin, enable us to live by Islam, die with Iman. Ya Arhamar Rahimin, enable us to remember yourself, remember our Akhirah and death so that we may prepare for that final day, Ya Arhamar Rahimin. Have mercy upon us in this world, mercy upon us in the grave, mercy upon us on the Day of Judgment, mercy upon us on the Bridge of Sirat, save us from the torments of fire by your Fadl and Rahmah, Ya Arhamar Rahimin. Grant us your love, the love of your beloved Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, the love of the pious and the pious and the righteous deeds, Ya Rabbal Alameen. Enable our hearts to be enlightened with your gnosis and marifa and your dhikr. Enable our hearts to be in your presence and be in the state of thankfulness, Ya Rahman Rahimin. Bless us with the goodness of this world and hereafter. Bless us with the sirati mustaqim and the guidance. Save us from the evils of shaitan, evils of the creation, evil of the dunya and evil of ourselves. Ya Rahman Rahimin, forgive us, our parents, our relatives, all the Muslim ummah which is living, who has passed away with Iman, especially the grandparents and all the ancestors of Brother Naweed up to Sayyidina Adam Alayhi Islam, who passed away with Iman. Forgive any person who is here, their friends and relatives and grandparents or parents who passed away. Ya Rahman Rahimin. Ya Rabbal Alameen, Ya Rahman Rahimin, elevate the status and the darajat of Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam and all the Anbiya and Awliya and Sahaba and Ahlul Bayt Tahar, Ya Rahman Rahimin. Enable us to live by the Sunnah of Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam and earn halal livelihood, to pray five times a day, to fulfill our obligation. Grant us, enable us to live by the akhlaq and the conduct and the character of Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Give us tolerance and forbearance, Ya Rahman Rahimin. Enable us to decorate our outer self, our inner self, with your love and the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Have mercy upon all the ummah in Palestine, in Iraq, in Syria, in Burma, in West and East and South, and all of the world, Ya Rahman. Help the oppressed. Enable us to help the oppressed, Ya Rahman Rahimin, and guide those people who are wronging and who are oppressing people toward the right path and toward justice. Ya Rahman Rahimin. Ya Rabbal Alameen, Ya Rahman Rahimin. Whoever has any lawful need, whoever is in this majlis or hearing on the internet, fulfill their lawful needs. Whoever has any problem, any difficulty, remove. Whoever is in any bad relationship, any relationship of disputes, quarrels between husband and wife, between families, set their hearts, unite their hearts with love and affection, Ya Rahman Rahimin. Enable all the families to live with tranquility and peace with each other, Ya Rahman Rahimin. Ya Rabbal Rahimin, Ya Rahman Rahimin. Whenever the time of death comes, enable us to die in a good place by doing good deeds, by saying something good, by your remembrance. Our lips are moving in your remembrance as they are now, Ya Rahman Rahimin. Wa sallallahu ta'ala ala khair khalqi wa nuri ash sayyidina wa nabiyyina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. Ameen. Wa rahmatika ya arhamar rahimin. Mashallah. Jazakallah. Astaghfirullah.